Hello friends, myself Dr. Ajay Prasad. I will be presenting to you a session on email security and tips to follow over it. In this session and video, we will be discussing emailing, which has almost become a regular part of our daily lives. And thereafter, we will discuss the security aspects of email services as well as threats pertaining to individuals and know few tips of keeping us safe while using email services. Let us look at the major takeaways from this session. After going through this video, you will be able to first understand email services, email formats, and email working, discuss about security requirements on email, comprehend briefly about email security protocols and technologies, recognize spams, spywares, and malwares, and the last, be vigilant and careful while using email services. Friends, this session is a part of email security which falls under a wider subject known as cyber security. Email security refers to the collective measures used to secure the access and contents of an email account or service. It allows an individual or organization to protect the overall access to one or more email addresses or accounts. An email service provider implements email security to secure subscriber email accounts and data from hackers at rest and as well as in transit. Email security is a priority for all businesses. With the growing threat of hackers, viruses, spam, phishing and identity theft, as well as the need of secure business information, email security can be defined as various techniques for keeping sensitive information in email communication and accounts secure against unauthorized access, loss, or compromise. The flow of this session will be, first, we will look at what is an email. In this, we will learn components of email and its structure, parts of an email protocols, protocols used in emailing, email working. What is email security is the next that we'll learn. In that, we will learn email security services and requirements, and then other threats in emailing. And then finally, we will learn email security tips. What is an email? Let us briefly discuss it so that all of us come on the same page of understanding. One can express emails as messages distributed by electronic means from one computer user to one or more recipients via a network. This will remind you of the postal services provided by the government and other private bodies. One had to write or type message and envelope it and post it at the nearest post box. The recipient address was to be written or typed on the envelope. The postal service people used to sort the envelope and direct the message or mail to different locations as per the addresses. The postman was the one who used to finally deliver the letter at the recipient site. In emailing, the complete messaging from writing one to sending and then receiving and reading is done via electronic means. The electronic means here are computers and networks, mostly the internet. Mostly the electronic means involve a personal computer or a hand device and the internet. Email was invented by Ray Tomlinson. Email first entered limited use in 1960s, and by the mid 70s, it had taken the form now recognized as email. Computer engineer Ray Tomlinson sent the first email in 1971. The email was sent from one computer to another computer sitting right beside in the Cambridge, Massachusetts. But it traveled via ARPANET, a network of computers that was the precursor to the internet. Let us now segregate all the important components of emailing and look at them closely. Emailing is a process where a sender writes a message, that is a letter, and sends it to a specific address or addresses. The main item in this process are email service provider, email application, sender having an email address, receiver having an email address, outbox of the sender, inbox of the receiver, internet, and
Attachments. What are email service providers? The email service provider, like the postal service, maintains a server to cater to the request pertaining email services. There are many email service providers. In spite of social network buzz, email still remains the core of business communication on the internet. As such, it is just important to evaluate the best email services available and make a choice that suits your need. Gmail is arguably the best free email service provider at the moment. Gmail is simple and user-friendly. It offers over 10 GB of free storage, has an excellent spam filter, and enables access via mobile devices. Its built-in chat allows voice and video chat as well as regular chatting by text. Outlook.com is the new reinvented Hotmail.com email service. It builds off the power of Outlook on PCs and Macs, and it features a more tidy user interface without display of ads. It is built based on the latest trend in internet communication. The new Yahoo Mail stands among the best free email services available on the web and mobile devices. They offer unlimited email storage, social networking, instant messaging, and SMS texting. AOL Mail is a free email service provider. It also provides complete security against spam and viruses, as well as it provides unlimited storage facility to the users. AOL Mail email attachment limits to a 25 MB. It links with other email accounts from other service providers also. The email service provider provides a web application known as email application, which helps user to write or type messages, that is letters, as senders to be sent to a receiver's address who can use the application to read messages received. Both the sender and receiver has their own addresses known as email addresses. Email address has two parts, username and domain name, concatenated by an @ symbol. The email application also helps users to maintain their inbox, where he receives all messages sent to him. An email attachment is a computer file sent along with an email message. One or more files can be attached to any email message and be sent along with it to the recipient. This is also typically used as simple method to share documents and images. Just like in courier services, we can attach documents, images, etc. from local system to be sent to the receiver. These are simply called as attachments. Almost all email services allow attachments like archive files, for example, zip files, rar files, tar files, gzip files, etc. We can also attach audio files like MP3, MPEG, WAV, etc. We can attach image files as well, like JPEG, JPG, PNG, GIF, bitmaps, etc. We can also attach video files like WebM, MPEGs, 3GPs, movies, AVIs, MPEG, GAP, GPS, WMV, FLV, etc. along with text files. All the email services can be used only when the user system is connected to the internet.
Let us now bring our focus on email message. Email message has many parts, and it includes those parts which we do not create. That is, apart from the message, the email contains information about the message, that is, the metadata of an email. Let us look into some of these important aspects.
Email message can be looked into basically on two parts, the metadata or information about the message and its source and destinations in the message format. The message format mainly consists of message header, header files, and then we have message body, where we have content encoding as well as the text or in HTML form. The message header includes following fields which are directly visible. These are from, to, date, subject, CC, BCC. The from field contains the email address and optionally the name of the authors. In many email clients, not changeable except through changing account settings. That is, we can't change our own address as at will. The date field contains the local time and date when the message was written. Like the from field, many email clients fill this in automatically while sending. The recipient's client may then display this time in the format and time zone local to them. The to field contains the email addresses and optionally names of message recipients. It indicates primary recipients that we can have multiply allowed. For secondary recipients, we use fields like CC and BCC. Subject field contains a brief summary of the topic of the message. Certain abbreviations are commonly used in the subject field like RE colon and forward. For forward, FW. CC field contains the list of addresses you need to copy the message to, also called as carbon copy. The BCC field contains the list of addresses you need to copy the message to, but you don't want to make it visible to anyone else apart from the one you have BCC'd. It is also called as blind carbon copy. There are many fields which are not visible directly through the email application. They are content type, precedence, message ID, in reply to, references, reply to, sender, archived at, authentication results, received SPF, auto submitted, etc. The content type field contains information about how the message is to be displayed using a MIME type. The precedence field contains mainly values like bulk, junk, or list used to indicate that automated vacation or out of office responses should not be returned for this mail. Example, to prevent vacation notices from being sent to all other subscribers of a mailing list. Send mail uses this field to affect prioritization of queued email with precedence, special delivery, etc. With modern high bandwidth networks, delivery priority is less of an issue than it once was. Message ID, also an automatically generated field, is used to prevent multiple delivery and for reference in reply to. In reply to, message ID of the message that is a reply to is used to link related messages together. This field only applies for reply messages. References. Message ID of the message that is a reply to and the message ID of the message previously reply was a reply to, etc. is added in this field. Reply to field consists addresses that should be used to reply to the message. Sender field contains addresses of the actual sender acting on behalf of the author listed in field in from field. Like for example, secretary, list of manager, etc. Archived at field is a direct link to archived form of an individual email message. Authentication results is used when a server carries out authentication checks. It can save the results in this field for consumption by downstream agents. Received SPF stores results of SPF checks in more detail than authentication results. And the last one is auto submitted, which is used to mark automatically generated messages. These are the various fields that we have, and there are many more. Let us now look at various protocols used while providing email services. Unless we follow protocols, emails from two different providers, we will never reach each other. You may be knowing the importance of protocols. Protocols in computer science are a set of rules or procedures for transmitting data between electronic devices such as computers. Emailing is possible over varied networks by following common protocols by the service providers. Simple Mail Transfer Protocol, SMTP, is a protocol which defines text-based messages or commands for forwarding email between mail submission agent and the mail delivery agent, that is MSA and MDA. Internet Message Access Protocol, that is IMAP, is a protocol which allows user application to access mail stored by MDA, that is mail delivery agent. It supports several clients, can be connected to same mailbox, separate retrieval of MIME parts of a message. Example attachment. IMAP over SSL is also a protocol that is used, which is abbreviated as IMAPS, I-M-A-P-S. Post office protocol is another popular mail retrieval protocol where client connects, gets email, deletes messages on server. One client can connect at a time. POP3 over SSL is an example and is abbreviated as POP3S, that is POP3S. How does emailing work? The sender composes a message using the email client on their computer. When the user sends the message, the email text and attachments are uploaded to SMTP, Simple Mail Transfer Protocol server, as outgoing mail. All outgoing messages wait in the outgoing mail queue while the SMTP server communicates with the DNS to find out where the recipient of the email server is located. DNS is abbreviation of domain name server. If the SMTP server finds the recipient email server, it will transfer the message and attachments. If the recipient server can't be found, the sender will get a mail failure notification in their inbox. The next time the recipient clicks send and receive, their email client will download all new messages from their own email server. And now you have got the mail. Right, friends, now that we have a brief idea about emailing, how it's done, the protocols and tools and technologies in email, we can start realizing as well as understanding what can be the security issues or requirements that we should or must have in email services. Let's ponder into them. Let us now talk about email security. What is email security? As mentioned in the beginning, email security refers to the collective measures used to secure the access and content of an email account or service. It allows an individual or organization to protect the overall access to one or more email addresses or accounts. Although almost all service providers provide quite a good security on emailing, even then, individual users of email services like us, you and me, must have to be careful not to fall into traps or unknowingly make faults which can result into loss of privacy, confidentiality, and many other email security breaches. Many tools and technologies are prevalent to ensure more safety and security while using emailing. Now let us focus on various security services provided and required in emailing services. Security services over email. What are the security expectations from an emailing service? Some of the security aspects that we should expect are privacy, authentication, integrity, non-repudiation, proof of submission, proof of delivery, message flow confidentiality, anonymity, audit, accounting, and last, message sequence integrity. Privacy is the ability of an individual or group to seclude themselves or information about themselves and thereby express themselves selectively. Email privacy is that no one should be able to read messages except the recipient. Authentication is the process or action of proving or showing something to be true, genuine, or valid. Authentication is the process of recognizing a user's identity. In email terms, recipient should know exactly who the sender is. Integrity. In the context of computer systems, integrity refers to methods of ensuring that the data is real, accurate, and safeguarded from unauthorized user modification. Data integrity in the context of networking refers to the overall completeness, accuracy, and consistency of the data. Data integrity must be imposed when sending data through a network. Integrity in email terms is that recipient should be able to tell whether message was altered in the transit or in the at the recipient side even. Non-repudiation. Non-repudiation is the assurance that someone cannot deny something. Typically, non-repudiation refers to the ability to ensure that a party to a contract or a communication cannot deny the authenticity of their signature on a document or the sending of a message that they had originated. Non-repudiation in email terms is that recipient can prove that sender has really sent it and no one else is portraying as original sender. In many cases, it is necessary that the sender needs confirmation and can be able to prove that the mail sent is noted and the recipient has received it. Proof of submission means verification to the sender that the mailer has got it. Proof of delivery means verification to the sender that the recipient got it. Message flow confidentiality. Message flow confidentiality means that an eavesdropper cannot determine the sender's ID. In fact, a third party cannot even know whether there was an email or not. Auditing is a primary aspect of every business or organization. For performing audits, we need to maintain logging of events, especially events which are having relevance to security. Hence, logs of emailing activities must have to be maintained. Accounting. Accounting is used to maintain usage statistics. In some cases, it is charged for the service that you get for accounting in many email services. Message sequence integrity provides proof that the ordering of sequence of message has been preserved when transmitted in the network environment. This service is provided on a recipient-to-recipient basis to protect message sequencing threats, such as replaying and reordering of messages. Message sequence integrity also means that sequence of messages have arrived in order without loss. Friends, most of our services are best provided using cryptographic means. What is cryptography? Cryptography is a technique to encrypt a message or in general data using a key and a defined mathematical procedure. The original message is also called as a plain text and the encrypted message is called as ciphertext. It is the ciphertext that has to be transferred so that a man in the middle isn't able to read the message. This enables the users to communicate securely, avoiding threats of sneaking privacy. These cryptographic means are provided in emailing via standards like S/MIME or programs like PGP, etc. What is S/MIME? Secure Multi-Purpose Internet Mail Extensions. It enables email security features by providing encryption, authentication, message integrity, and other related services. It ensures that an email message is sent by a legitimate sender and provides encryption for incoming and outgoing messages. Pretty Good Privacy. PGP is an encryption program that provides cryptographic privacy and authentication for data communication. PGP is used for signing, encrypting, and decrypting texts, emails, files, directories, and whole disk partitions to increase the security of email communications. There are many other protocols or procedures that are used to provide security services in emailing. They are Sender Policy Framework, called as SPF protocol, Domain Keys Identification Mail, also called as DKMIM protocol, Domain-Based Message Authentication, Reporting and Confirmation, also abbreviated as DMARC. Sender Policy Framework is an authorization mechanism for domains. Its main purpose is simply to allow a receiving server to verify that an email has come from a domain that is allowed. DKIM, that is Domain Keys Identified Mail, allows the server not only to verify that an email was sent by a particular domain, but also that the domain itself authorized the email. Main purpose of SPF and DKIM is simply to make domain-based blacklists and whitelists. Domain-based message authentication, reporting and confirmation, DMARC, adds on to the SPF and DKIM. It adds policy details that can be stored in DNS, that is domain name service, and creates a reporting and conformance resign where receivers can update email senders, that is domains, with feedback on mail coming from their domains. These protocols are more of specialized ones and not all free email services have them. Let us have a look at some indirect threats to emailing. Apart from security requirements like privacy, authentication, etc. discussed earlier, there are threats in emailing which has very different modality of intrusion and are more serious than many security requirements discussed before. We will introduce you with certain threats or ways security breaches can happen in emailing. They are spams, spywares, malware, phishing, masquerading, malvertising, eavesdropping, snooping, etc. Email spam. Email spam are also known as unsolicited bulk email, that is abbreviated as UBE or junk mail, is the practice of sending unwanted email messages, frequently with commercial content, in large quantities. Spam email is a form of commercial advertising which is economically viable because email is a very cost-effective medium for the sender. If just a fraction of recipients of an email spam message purchase the advertised product, the spammers are making money and the spam problem is perpetuated, that is spread. Spams can be used most generally to transfer spyware, malware, phishing, malvertising. That is the problem that we are talking about. Malware is a short for malicious software. Computer programs designed to infiltrate and damage computers without the user's consent. Malware is a general term covering all different types of threats to your computer safety, such as viruses, spyware, worms, trojans, rootkits, and so on. Spyware is unwanted software that infiltrates your computing device, stealing your internet usage data and sensitive information. Spyware is classified as a type of malware, malicious software designed to gain access to or damage your computer, often without your knowledge. How does spyware and malware get through your email into your system? Mainly by phishing. Phishing is a type of social engineering attack often used to steal user data, including login credentials and credit card numbers. It occurs when an attacker masquerading as a trusted entity dupes a victim into opening an email, instant message, or text message. Phishing email will typically direct the user to visit a website where they are asked to update personal information such as password, credit card, social security credentials, or bank account numbers that the legitimate organization already has. How to recognize phishing? Never open emails that contain messages containing threats to shut your account down. Never open emails that contains requests for personal information such as passwords or social security numbers. Never open emails that contain words like urgent and creates a false sense of urgency. Never open emails that contain forged email addresses that are addresses which are fake. Never open emails that contain poor writing or bad grammar. Hover your mouse over links before you click on them to see if the URL looks legitimate or not. Another threat can be masquerading. In general, a masquerade is a disguise. In terms of communication, security issues, a masquerade is a type of attack where the attacker pretends to be an authorized user of a system in order to gain access to it or gain greater privileges than they are authorized for. Malvertising is an abbreviation of malicious advertising. It is the use of online advertising to spread malware. It typically involves injecting malicious or malware-laden advertisements into legitimate online advertising networks and web pages. Cyber criminals use the same advertising strategies as legitimate companies, except that malvertisements will either try to download malware directly to visitors' devices upon viewing, or send visitors to websites that distribute viruses, ransomware, or other malicious programs. Malvertising is a favorite medium for criminal behavior because it takes advantage of consumer trust in companies and advertising networks. This type of attack is often run on websites that run third-party ads. How to identify malvertisements? Look for ads that do not look like they were made by a professional graphic designer. They may be malvertised. Ads that can have spelling errors. Ads that promise miraculous cures or celebrity scandals. If it sounds too good to be true, then it is probably a malvertisement. Ads that do not match your recent typical search history or browsing behavior. They might be malvertisements. Eavesdropping. Eavesdropping is the act of secretly or stealthily listening to the private conversation or communication of others without their consent. Eavesdropping is the unauthorized real-time interception of a private communication, such as a phone call, instant message, video conference, or fax transmission. The term eavesdrop derives from the practice of actually standing under the eaves of a house, listening to conversations inside. The same thing can happen in emailing also. Snooping can include casual observance of an email that appears on another's computer screen or watching what someone else is typing. More sophisticated snooping uses software programs to remotely monitor activity on a computer or a network device.
Finally, friends, now we know what email security is and briefly understand how these security services are provided to users. Also, we have made a perception that however we are secure, threats can be there and we need to be extra vigilant ourselves rather than only dependent on the security services provided by the email service providers. Let us now see few email tips which are very important so that one can avoid security issues.
Security tip number one. Use strong passwords. Never use a password that contains very simple and well-known words. A secure password is almost impossible to guess without some insight. The only way a hacker will break into your system is if they use specialist password guessing software that will run through millions of combinations. The more complex password, the more time it takes for the software to figure it out. The passwords that follow the best practices outlined below would take 200 to 500 years to break. Let us look at the essentials for a strong password. Use upper and lower case letters. Use numbers and special characters in your password. Use random numbers and letters rather than words. Never use your birthday, hometown, school, university, or brand name in your passwords. Avoid common letters, numbers, situations, substitutions, etc. Think in terms of phrases rather than words. Security number two, change your password often. Use a different password for each of your accounts. If you use the same password for your bank account as you do for your email account, you become much more vulnerable to data theft as well as money. Security tip number three, don't open an attachment unless you know who it is from and whether you are expecting it or not. Never open unexpected attachment without scanning. Sometimes your business will receive emails that contains file attachments. That is not a problem if you notice the email from your accountant and you know you are waiting for them to send information. It is rarely an issue when the email comes from a customer or a client either. However, occasionally your company will get a phishing email. Such emails come from an unknown source and contains files for you to open. Of course, you cannot go putting all those messages straight in the trash, because many of them might be genuine message. For that reason, you need to invest in email threat protection systems. You should consider using antiviruses, anti-malware, email security softwares to scan all correspondence, as well as implement advanced spam filters. That should let you know if there is any need for concern while opening the email attachment. If the program tells you there is a problem, you can delete the message, block the sender, and secure your system. That way, you can prevent a business email compromise and a subsequent data security breach. Security tip number 4. Enable macros only when you are sure of the document or worksheets. Be cautious about email messages that instruct you to enable macros before downloading Word or Excel attachments. In Word, you can automate frequently used tasks by creating and running macros. A macro is a series of commands and instructions that you group together as a single command to accomplish a task automatically. If you have tasks in Microsoft Excel that you do repeatedly, you can record a macro to automate those tasks. A macro is an action or a set of actions that you can run as many times as you want. Many times, the hackers use Excel and Word, etc. as carriers of viruses, worms, trojans, etc., which can damage your system or steal your data or credentials. Security tip number 5. Use antivirus, anti-malware software on your local machine and make sure it is kept up to date with the latest virus definitions. Many good and proven antivirus softwares are available, like Norton, Avira, Kaspersky, McAfee, Panda, BullGuard, etc. Security tip number 6. Use a robust spam filter. A spam filter is a program that is used to detect unsolicited and unwanted email that prevent those messages from getting to a user's inbox. Like other types of filtering programs, a spam filter looks for certain criteria on which it bases its judgment whether to spam a particular email or not. There are many types of spam filters. A filtering solution applied to your email system uses a set of protocols to determine which of your incoming messages are spam and which are not. There are several different types of spam filters available. One is content filters, which reviews the content within a message to determine if it is a spam or not. Another can be header filters, which reviews the email header in search of a falsified information. There are general blacklist filters, spams, which stop all emails that come from a blacklisted file or a known spammer. A spam filter can be rule-based, which uses user-defined criteria, such as specific senders or specific wording in subject line or the body to block the spam. Then there can be a permission filter, spam, which require anyone sending a message to be pre-approved by the recipient. There is a challenge response filter based spam filters, which require anyone sending a message to enter a code in order to gain permission to send email. Security tip number 7. Be aware of phishing emails. If you receive an attachment from someone you don't know, then don't open it. Delete it immediately. Instead of clicking on the links in that message, open a new browser and manually type in the address that is given in the link. We have discussed about phishing and spams extensively in the previous part of this session. Please refer to the methods avoiding phishing emails. Before we can help you to keep your eyes peeled off for phishing attacks, it is sensible to explain the nature of domains for people who have not encountered the term in the past. Phishing is a straightforward concept many hackers use to steal email and account information by tricking individuals into handing over their details. The process usually works like this. The hacker sends emails that contains a link to your site you know. The victim clicks the link and finds themselves looking at a familiar website that is often their bank or something similar, but the site is fake. The victim then enters their email address and password to log into their account. The fake phishing site steals the email and password before passing it back to the hacker. When someone at a company falls victim to advanced malware attacks and phishing emails, it can become a disastrous situation. That is especially the case in instances where the businesses uses the same password for everyone in their office. Hopefully, that should help to highlight how important it can be that you develop strong and unique password for all your workers. A phishing attack is no longer as apparent as it used to be. Hackers are becoming increasingly sophisticated, making it more difficult to identify it unless you pay attention to details. What are the steps to take if you are a victim of a phishing scheme? Calm down, don't panic. Change your passwords. Contact the organization that was spoofed, meaning the phishing email would be masquerading upon. Scan your computer for viruses. Watch out for warning signs of identity theft. File a report with the security organization if you see any damages. Protect yourself against future phishing schemes. Security tip number 8. As discussed in the previous section, malvertising is a very frequent thing that you may encounter in an email inbox. Always be careful if you click on an advertisement directly on an email. It is advisable that you never click on an advertising link directly. Security tip number 9. Don't give your email address to sites you don't trust. Don't post your email addresses to public websites or forums. Spammers often scan these sites for email addresses. Don't click the unsubscribe link in a spam email. It would only let the spammer know your address is legitimate, which could lead you to receive more spam. Understand that reputable businesses will never ask for personal information via email. So if someone calls you or someone mails you asking for your credit card number, etc., that means it is a fake thing, because never a bank will call for your credit card number. Security tip number 10. Don't send personal information in an email message. If by any means the recipient has malicious intents, or he or she forwards it to another person having malicious intentions, then you might get into a trouble. Personal information may be like date of birth, card number, phone number, private details, photographs, authentication details, addresses, etc. Security tip number 11. Don't reply to a spam. Be aware that if you reply to a spam email, your reply most likely will not go back to the original spammer, because the from header in the spam message will most likely be forged. Security tip number 12. Never share your passwords with anyone. Not even to the closest friends and even spouses. It has been found many a times that the friend or spouse having or knowing one's password has done crimes like masquerading, snooping, etc. Don't be a fool. Password is like your hand and finger. Never trust anyone for it. Trust only yourself. Security tip number 13. Never access emails from a public Wi-Fi. Public Wi-Fi are many times compromised and also many times are used as phishing tool. Once you enter your secret code or password over Wi-Fi, which is not secure, then you are vulnerable as to where the passwords, etc. are going and getting logged. Just for the sake of free internet, one must not compromise his or her credentials. Security tip number 14. Be sure to log out. If you are using a public PC, or a system which will be used next by someone else, you never know who it will be and whether in which way your logged in email service can be used maliciously. Log out from the service and ensure deleting all the cookies and saved passwords from the browser history, and then shut down the system before leaving.
Friends, before closing, let us summarize what we learned in this session. We learned what actually is emailing and emails. We learned that email service providers use a set of protocols like SMTP, IMAP, POP, etc. We also learned that emailing services contains security features like cryptography, etc., which are provided using protocols like SMIME, PGP, sender policy framework, domain keys identified mail, domain-based message authentication, reporting and confirmation. We had an insight on various security requirements and an email service. We saw what are other indirect threats and means of attacks which use email vulnerabilities. Lastly, we observed various tips to keep ourselves secure while using emailing. Hope this video session gave you a better insight on emailing. It is very vital that emailing services are used properly and cautiously so that we don't get into bad hands. Thank you and wish you all the best.